environmentalist Baba Dean once said, "We will conserve only what we love. We will love only what we understand. We know so little about the ocean. It is a mystery to us, and as a result, we are not fully able to love and conserve this precious habitat and creation for time to come. Because I, Joshua, and my partner Hannah believe that we must explore the oceans in order to better understand and protect it, we stand resolved that the United States federal government should substantially increase its non-military exploration and or development of the Earth's oceans. This is a comparative advantage case in which we show our policies and advantages over the status quo. If by the end of the round you believe our plan creates a better one than the status quo, please vote affirmative." I'd like to first define the most important term in today's debate, ocean exploration. According to NOAA, the National Oceans and Atmospheric Administration, ocean exploration is making discoveries, searching for things unusual, unexpected, unknown. It includes observations and documentation of biological, chemical, physical, geological, and archaeological aspects of the ocean. Findings expand our fundamental scientific knowledge and understanding and lay the foundation for more detailed hypothesis-based scientific investigations. Additional definitions will be provided upon request and cross-examination. In order to understand why we're advocating for an increase in exploration, let's begin with contention one inherency and learn about the current state of U.S. ocean exploration. Point 8, 95% of the ocean is unexplored. Grace Young of Ocean Engineering at MIT writes in May 2014, 95% of the Earth's oceans remain unexplored. The result is a perilous dearth in knowledge about our planet at a time when rapid changes in our marine ecosystems profoundly affect its habitability. Point B, exploration underfunded and underprioritized. Craig McLean, the Assistant Director of Science for the National Evolutionary Synthesis Center, writes in 2012, "Ocean exploration has suffered from chronic underfunding and the lack of an independent agency with a dedicated mission. What limits our exploration of the oceans is not technology, but funding. We as a society started to make a choice to deprioritize ocean exploration and science. Funding of marine science and exploration are at historical lows. The NOAA Office of Ocean Exploration took the second biggest cut of all programs and has fallen 33% since 2009. Point C, exploration budget cut. NOAA states in its fiscal year 2015 budget summary that for ocean exploration and research, NOAA requests a decrease of $7 million to reduce exploration of unknown and poorly known ocean areas and phenomena. NOAA shows a decreasing emphasis on ocean exploration by cutting its exploration budget. This drops the overall NOAA exploration budget to $19.2 million for fiscal year 2015. Thus, we advocate the passage of the following policy. The United States federal government should substantially increase its exploration of the Earth's oceans through the establishment, funding, and utilization of a federal ocean science and exploration agency, also known as OC. This OC will be an independent federal agency located in the Department of the Interior, whose mission is devoted to pure exploration of our Earth's oceans, seeking to increase oceanic knowledge and discover the unknown, and to lay the foundation for future oceanographic study. Implementation and enforcement through normal governmental means, OC's annual budget shall be $3 billion. If you have any specific questions about our plan, please feel free to ask. Next, contention two is workability. What does an OC look like? Craig McLean, also a writer for Deep Sea News, explains in 2012. OC would be dedicated to basic exploration of the world's oceans. OC would need research vessels, a submersible, remotely operated vehicles, and autonomous underwater vehicles. An ocean exploration center would be staffed with a vibrant community working toward uncovering the mysteries of the ocean. Research would be funded internally from a broad OC budget, freeing scientists and engineers to actually do science and engineering. Contention 3 solvency, or why our specific policy is key for U.S. ocean exploration. Current institutions inadequate. A dedicated OC is key to boost exploration. McLean continues in his article written in 2012 that the creation of a NASA-style agency, OC, ensures the future health of U.S. ocean exploration. Although parts of OC are realized in other government organizations, they do not meet the full mission of this pivotal moment. NOAA fills a much-needed role, but its mission is largely applied. In an agency with a chiefly applied mission, programs that are purely exploratory must eventually invent an applied focus or face the axe. The current situation at NOAA highlights how less applied scientific programs are likely to be lost. It is time for a great national effort of the USA to renew our commitment to uncovering the mysteries of the Blue Planet. We need an ocean science and exploration agency to explore the greatest depths of oceans. Lastly, let's take a look at two advantages our plan has over the current system. Advantage one is greater protection of ocean resources. Point A, significance. 95% of the ocean is unexplored. Point B, significance. We lack fundamental ocean knowledge. Only after dedicated ocean exploration can we understand it. Larry Meyer, the director of the Center for Coastal Mapping, writes in 2013 that there is so much we don't know about the ocean. Given our limited understanding, we must extend our study of the oceans to not only include the scientific process of testing specific hypotheses, which is research, but also a program of exploration to significantly increase the chances of making new discoveries. Only after many years of systematic exploration will we be able to say that we do understand the wondrous ocean that is so fundamental in sustaining us. Point C, solvency. Exploration crucial to ocean resource sustainability. Ocean Literacy, a branch College of Exploration, states in January 2015 that understanding the ocean is more than a matter of curiosity. Exploration, inquiry, and study are required to better understand ocean systems and processes. Use of ocean resources has increased significantly. Therefore, the future sustainability of ocean resources depends on our understanding of those resources and their potential and limitations. Point D, solvency. Exploration promotes ocean stewardship and conservation. Alan Jameson, the senior lecturer at Ocean Lab at the University of Aberdeen, writes in December 2014, exploration benefits the responsible stewardship of the oceans. Conservation and maintenance of the seas relies on us really understanding it. Changes that happen in the ocean will have an effect on the largest habitat on Earth, yet people question why we study the deep sea. How can we conserve the largest habitat on Earth if we know nothing about it? Point E, impact. Conservation now is necessary. The oceans are on the verge of extinction, but if we act now, we can still avert its collapse. Carl Zimmer, a science journalist for the New York Times, reports in January 2015. Scientists, in a groundbreaking analysis of data from hundreds of sources, concluded that humans are on the verge of causing unprecedented damage to the animals, to the oceans and animals living within them. We may be sitting on a precipice of a major extinction event, said Macaulay, an ecologist at UC Santa Barbara and author of the research published in the journal Science. But there is still time to avert catastrophe, Dr. Macaulay found. The oceans are mostly intact, still wild enough to bounce back to ecological health. This is a call for action to close the gap between conservation on land and in the sea. Advantage 2 is increased economic growth. Point A, significance. Ocean exploration is seriously underfunded in the status quo. Point B, solvency. Ocean exploration will further the economy, jobs, technology, and research. McLean in 2012 concludes this article. There is much to be gained from creating an ocean science and exploration agency and exploring the oceans. Every dollar we commit to science returns $2.21 in goods and services. Meeting the demands of scientific exploration creates jobs and requires substantial personnel beyond just scientists and engineers. Materials purchased for this cost support even further employment, and knowledge gained from basic research will form the backbone for applied research and economic gain later. Point C, solvency. Protecting and conserving the oceans protects our economy. Philip Cousteau, a board director for the Ocean Conservancy, writes in 2012, through ocean exploration, we have the opportunity to course correct when it comes to stewardship of our oceans. Exploration can go hand in glove with resource management and conservation. We've exploited and polluted our oceans at an alarming rate without dedicating the needed time or resources to truly understand the critical role they play in the future of the planet. Destroying our ocean resources has devastating consequences for the global economy and the health and sustainability of all creatures, including humans. For too long, the United States has not put forth an emphasis on the exploration of the oceans. We urgently need to change this by devoting more time, resources, and money into this vital area. A vote in affirmation will help us to better protect our environment and sustain it for future generations. Only with a better understanding of the oceans through exploration will we be able to conserve it. Thank you. I'm now open for cross-examination. That was a significance and it's stating about how little we know about the oceans.
Okay, now when it's talking about the oceans, it's talking about how little we know about the ocean's geological formations?
We know, there's data from satellite maps of the topography of the ocean floor, but we don't actually have much data about the creatures within it and the ecosystems.
Okay, so why is there your source from a mapping agency then? Do maps solve for marine life?
Not necessarily. It's someone who works at NOAA, the director of the Center for Coastal Mapping.
Now when you say that 95% of the ocean is unexplored, does this mean that we haven't been through 95% of the ocean?
It's like we haven't explored that part of our area.
So have we not been there, or what do you mean?
Yeah,
by
we haven't been there.
Explored?
We haven't like gone to those ecosystems or observed them or have monitoring of those ecosystems.
So when you say that, does it where has the United States and where has the rest of the world actually explored? Where is that 5% located?
It's towards the top of the surface of the water, as well as we have maps of the topography, but we don't necessarily have gone to different ecosystems that are in rare places, and we haven't explored.
Okay, so ecosystems in rare places, where are these located?
Well, I don't exactly know for myself, but the plan of the OCE is to guide and unify ocean exploration, just like sort of how NASA guided and unified space exploration.
Okay, so,
so
NASA had the goal of getting something to say to the moon. Where is your plan? Where's the goal of your plan?
As it states in our mission statement, this is based off of the NASA mission statement. It is an independent federal agency whose mission is devoted to pure exploration of our Earth's oceans.
Okay, but where are you specifically going first?
we don't specifically quantify, because as Congress people, we don't necessarily, the Congress people don't necessarily decide where the scientists are going to explore. The scientists conclude and they discuss.
So you could be in the middle of the Pacific Ocean between the top half and bottom half in a bunch of water, basically.
Unexplored places of the ocean that we haven't been before and we don't have information on.
Okay. Now when you say $3 billion, how many missions does this actually fund?
We don't actually need to. We don't actually specify this because missions range in costs from costs greatly. But we base it off of the NASA budget, which is
okay,
also.
Okay, so how do you? Why would you use the NASA budget when ocean exploration is distinct in terms of the amount of technology used and the types of technology needed and the amount of research necessary?
Ocean exploration and spatial exploration are similar because both are very expensive, are hard to find, and.
So are they the exact same expense, and do they require the same personnel? Require the same staffing and the same bureaucracy levels?
Not necessarily, but what we're saying is that ocean exploration is so underfunded in the status quo, and we need to increase this to a substantial rate.
One more question. If the ocean is 95% explored, how do you know that $3 billion is sufficient?
Well, I guess if
Should I
answer?
Yeah, I guess so.
It's just saying that it's more beneficial than the status quo, and it's a substantial increase, and if $3 billion isn't enough, then there's no way that the current exploration budget of $19.2 million will be anywhere close to that.
I'd like to take 1 minute of prep time. Judges, looking at the affirmative team's case as a whole, we can see that really they lack the crucial links to show that there is both an impetus and something preventing their plan from being enacted in the status quo. With that said, my name is Dante, and I'll be your first negative constructive speaker in today's debate, and I'll be showing you why the affirmative team's plan should not be passed. With that said, I'll be addressing the issues of first topicality before moving on to inherency, and then addressing the issues of their first advantage specifically in regards to the data gaps that exist for ocean protection. But initially, let's begin with the issue of topicality. Now, we can essentially see that one of the main reasons why they're not topical is because, in addition to exploring, one of the things that they're actually mandating is research. And if we look at the definition that they read from the NOAA, they define ocean exploration as making discoveries and searching for things that are unusual and unexpected. The negative team agrees that the NOAA would be a good source for topicality and the definition of exploration, given that the NOAA is the current leading sort of agent for ocean exploration in the status quo. However, we would like to provide another definition from the NOAA that actually goes on to further qualify what it means by this word discovery in regards to ocean exploration. And through this, we'll see that the affirmative plan, through doing such things as mapping, actually breaches beyond the bounds of merely discovery. This is from the NOAA Science Board in 2012. The panel affirms the definition of exploration, that it is a systematic search and investigation for the initial purpose of discovery, cataloging and documenting what one finds, boldly going where no one has gone before, and providing initial knowledge for hypothesis-based science. They affirm that ocean exploration is distinct from comprehensive surveys, such as those carried out by the NOAA Corps and at-sea research, including investigations aimed at the ocean bottom, water column, and marine life. So from this, we can essentially see that by mapping the ocean, what they're doing is essentially conducting a survey of, for example, the topography of the bottom of the ocean. In addition to this, when it comes to the various links, or rather, their first advantage when they read various things about how climate is affecting the ocean, we can see that this would also constitute research. Thus, we can see that because their plan reaches beyond the bound of exploration and actually includes research, on the other hand, that in that respect they are not topical. With that said, next let's look at the issue of inherency. Now they read several cards talking about how there's a barrier in the status quo, and first talk about how 90% of the ocean is currently unexplored. However, first we need to look at the fact that mostly they're talking about mapping in this respect, and they actually qualified this in the last cross-examination. But the negative team would like to read a card talking about how the ocean actually has been sufficiently mapped, and in fact it's to a considerably high resolution. Copley 2014. We often hear that the oceans are 95% unexplored, but what do we really mean? The entire ocean floor has now been mapped to a maximum resolution of around 5 kilometers, which means that we can see features of that size. That's the resolution of a new global map of the seafloor published recently by David Samuel of Scripps Institute of Oceanography. So from this sense, that we can see that the first subpoint that they read in their inherency does not stand, because the fact is this 95% figure that they read is not based in reality in the status quo. Next, they talk about funding cuts that have been going to the NOAA Office of Ocean Exploration and Research, but I'd like to point out that if you specifically look at what this office does, they don't specifically do exploration in and of themselves. Actually, one of the main things that they actually do is merely coordinate this exploration and research. Essentially, they're sort of a administrative body as opposed to the agents of this in and of themselves, which means that if you look at this, the card that they read in regards to this does not actually reflect the current state of exploration. NOAA 2010. The NOAA created the Office of Ocean Exploration to coordinate efforts and facilitate research expeditions. Cruises have been multidisciplinary endeavors conducted in conjunction with organizations such as the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute and several academic institutions. They partner with offices and programs that plan expeditions that take place within the nation's marine sanctuaries. So essentially what this is talking about is specifically what this Office of Ocean Exploration and Research that they talk about in their inherency point does. They facilitate research expeditions and coordinate exploration efforts. Neither of these are exploration or research in and of themselves. And it actually points out that namely when it comes to the NOAA doing research and exploration, they do so in conjunction with other bodies. What this means is that when it comes to the issue of funding, it essentially is moot because it's not reflective of the total amount of funding. Thus, the $19.2 million figure that they're talking about is not only talking about exploration and research, but rather the administrative efforts in regards to coordinating this. Consequently, we can see that thus there is really no barrier when it comes to their plan. And in fact, the negative team will read in the next week several cards talking about how there are a multitude of programs that are currently working to explore and research the ocean. Next, let's look at the issue of their first advantage, in which they talk about ocean protection. So now, the main crux of this point is that we have certain data gaps in the status quo when it comes to responding to these. What we need to look at, however, is the fact that currently the NOAA is actually faced with a very large amount of data, so much that they actually don't have the technology necessary to deal with it in the status quo. Thus, we can see that the issue of data insufficiency is being fixed, and consequently their plan is not necessary. Piotrowski, 2014. The Ocean Sciences meeting in Hawaii last month heard proposals for creating a comprehensive quality control database, which helps overcome limited scientific capacity. The explosion of ocean data being collected through modern methods exceeds scientists' capacity to deal with it. Interdisciplinary work that is crucial for answering questions such as what effect climate change is having on marine environments is sensitive to reliability issues. There is significant improvement on oceanographic databases hosted at the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration's Data Center. So what we can see from this is that the issue that they talk about this is already being solved in the status quo. There's actually an explosion of ocean data, thus showing us that really their plan won't change anything. But moreover, when it comes to the issue of responding to various climatic effects of the ocean, we need to look at the fact that the NOAA itself is investing very large sums of money in exploring this issue. Waldblum, 2014. Overall, NOAA funding looks strong, and the White House demonstrated support for increasing their funding. It is an improvement over federal year 2013 sequestration level. It also establishes a climate resilience fund and provides services needed for storm readiness and changing ocean conditions as well as changing economies. Ocean priorities will be strongly supported in the coming year. So what we can see from this is that when they read the several cards talking about how we need an agency that has a specific and dedicated mission to ocean exploration, that's essentially what's already happening, because the NOAA is already prioritizing the issues in regards to the ocean. There is no need to create a new agency when the fact is the status quo is already working. In addition to this, we need to look at the fact that when it comes to specifically issues of climate change and tsunamis, there are in fact various, or not tsunamis, but climate change and various other issues, there are also private businesses that are currently dealing with this issue. And the affirmative team has not shown that specifically creating the OC will be beneficial over these status quo efforts. Check Min 2015. The NOAA is meeting with scientists and various technology companies to explore and map 3.3 million miles of the ocean. It involves dozens of private and public partnerships with technology companies. They use sensors and data sent from vessels and are helping policymakers to get real-time information. So in essence, we can see that really there is no impetus for their plan, nor is there really any barriers for it, and they are not topical. For these reasons, I ask you to vote nay, and I now stand open for cross-examination and further points of clarification.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So first of all, what is the role of inherency in debate?
So inherency is essentially, it exists to show that the affirmative team's plan will not happen in the status quo. So it's to give the negative team an understanding of not only what's been happening in the past, but also a vision or the understanding that, say, tomorrow or next week, we're not going to suddenly see your plan being
approved. It doesn't relate to the harm and showing that the harm isn't being solved in the status quo?
Well, in a sense, it could relate to the harms, because the fact is, if a barrier does not exist, then the harm can also be solved.
If the barrier does not exist, but the harm is not being solved in the status quo, then isn't there also shown a need for change?
Well, the fact is, the harm is being solved in the status quo. We have an explosion of ocean data.
Okay, thank you. So you stated that we are untopical because we're increasing both research and exploration. Is correct?
Yes. So the NOAA themselves distinguish these two various issues.
So where exactly in our plan did you state we're increasing research?
You talk about various things in regards to mapping, and your first advantage in regards to protecting the ocean, which would require, for example, the study of biodiversity and various biological issues, which it specifically states in the card constitutes research.
But isn't going to unexplored places and gathering data from there unknown and just looking and seeing that, is that exploration?
Well, the thing is, you need to qualify what it means for something to be unexplored. We've seen that the entire ocean floor is mapped to a resolution of 5 kilometers. In that sense, you could potentially say that the entirety of the ocean has been explored because we currently have the topographical map showing us what exists there.
Okay, so if that's the case, then are there any topical exploration cases that can be run by the affirmative?
Well, you need to qualify once again what it means by exploration, because if you don't provide us a definition that specifically distinguishes various aspects of it, then there's essentially no way to gauge it.
So, you also stated that the NOAA Office of Ocean Exploration and Research is not necessarily exploring the oceans?
It's primarily a coordinating.
Okay. So, what other parts of NOAA are devoted to pure exploration, not, say, research?
Purely exploration?
Yep.
Well, essentially, every NOAA, the agencies under the NOAA, none of them are specifically focused on exploration. So for example, their National Ocean Service, in addition to doing various things that could be considered exploring the ocean, also, for example, observe the ocean and fund various satellites that do so.
Thank you. Lastly, moving on to your Copley 14 evidence, can I please have that piece of art? Can I have that evidence and the Piotrowski evidence too? And
yeah.
Also, was it in reference to satellite mapping?
It doesn't specify on the card, but it also talks about how, in addition to, the card does mention satellites, but I believe it also talks about buoys and other things.
Thank you.
I'll be taking a second.
questions as well.
Good afternoon, my name is Hannah and I'm your second affirmative constructive speaker in today's debate. I'm going to go down the flow and address my opponent's attacks on topicality, inherency, and our first advantage, and once again stress to you, the judges, why our plan is comparatively advantageous to the status quo and should be enacted by you, the judges. So starting with topicality, my opponent stated that that there's a difference between exploration and research and that our plan is doing research and not exploration. But again, we do stand under our own definition of ocean exploration, which comes from NOAA and has not been reputed as a non-reputable source. Ocean exploration is making discoveries, it's disciplined, systematic observations and documentation of biological, chemical, physical, geological, and archaeological aspects of the ocean. So this covers far more than mapping. It's biological, chemical, physical, geological, and archaeological. So it's not just the ocean floor or the terrain, it's actually the creatures in there, which is something that we're going to do through our case. Our plan does increase discoveries, it searches for unknown things, it does exactly what our definition requires, therefore we are increasing exploration through our plan and do retain that topicality point. Moving on to their second attack in regards to mapping, they said that a lot of the ocean has been explored through mapping, but again, mapping doesn't fully solve our advantages and is only a small part of ocean exploration. It takes a picture of the terrain of the seafloor, but it doesn't give us an understanding about how an ecosystem functions, about vital species and the effects of human technology on specific habitats. In this article from Smithsonian Magazine 2014, we can learn the difference between mapping and really exploring and understanding the ocean. When you look at available topographies of the seafloor, you get the impression that the job of mapping the planet is over, but far from it. These seemingly precise representations, based on satellite images, estimates of the ocean depths are not that revealing. They're rather like throwing a wet blanket over a table set for a fancy dinner party. You may see the outlines of four candles surrounded by a dozen chairs, but that's about it. You wouldn't see the utensils and the plates, and let alone what's for dinner. So satellite data only gives us a rough idea of what lies beneath the surface. And again, it's just a picture of the terrain. We don't understand what's actually in the ocean, the creatures that are there, how we're interacting with the creatures, and how human technology affects these. Therefore, that point falls as well because mapping, again, does not cover our case and there's no overlap there. As for their inherency attacks, they did state that merely funding cuts does not pose an inherent barrier. In the card that my partner read in the 1AC, Advantage 1.C, NOAA has cut several programs, has decreased funding for several programs that are for exploration, such as Aquinos and the EV Nautilus, different things that were going into the ocean and looking, and they have continued to cut their budgets year by year, which proves a clear attitudinal barrier. On top of that, my opponent stated that NOAA's priorities are indeed the ocean and ocean exploration. However, this is simply not true because the harms do exist in the status quo and are not being solved by the amount of exploration that NOAA does. NOAA is not prioritizing ocean exploration. Especially as my partner read a card in our 1AC, NOAA cuts anything that is purely exploratory, so anything that's going into the ocean just to explore, they cut anything like that, which is exactly our case, which again proves a clear barrier for our case being enacted into the status quo. Their third attack was in regards to private companies exploring the ocean, but again, private companies can't do what we need in the status quo, which is OC. Craig McLean, 2012. Although parts of OC are realized in other private organizations, they do not meet the full mission, nor can such a distributed structure be expected to meet the challenges of this pivotal moment. Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute provides another model that comes close to OC, but is heavily reliant on private funding, and that can often be significantly reduced during recessions as endowments shrink. A private foundation is unlikely to meet the full financial burden and support the full mission of OC or provide a resource to the ocean science community as a whole. So again, this describes why private organizations cannot cover what we need them to in the status quo, which is a separate agency that does have reliable funding and things like that. Again, private industries can't do this. They also stated that NOAA can explore the ocean, but as we've read several cards, we need a specific agency set aside for purely exploring the ocean at Zoning 14. It is far from enough to inject additional funding into ocean science. There must also be an agency with a mandate to envision and lead federal efforts to bolster ocean exploration the way that President Kennedy and NASA once led space research. Oceans are little steady, but a very promising area for enhanced exploration. More than moving a few billion dollars, however, to the oceans is called for. The United States needs an agency that can spearhead a major drive to explore the oceans, an agency that has yet to be envisioned and created. So this card again stresses why we need a specific agency to spearhead basically exploration of the ocean. NOAA can't do it, NOAA won't do it, and private organizations do not have the wherewithal to do it as well. Therefore, we do prove a need for our case in the status quo. There was a workability attack that my opponent brought up in regards to our funding. Again, we are substantially increasing ocean exploration, and as our evidence called for a NASA-style agency, we do implement that into the status. We would implement that into the status quo. Therefore, that workability attack falls, as again, it doesn't have any impact. As long as we inject funding, we are comparatively advantageous to the status quo, especially because it's $3 billion. And if $3 billion isn't enough, if that is what the negative team is arguing, then the status quo of $19 million is certainly not enough. Moving on to our advantage, our first advantage of protection of ocean resources. My opponent stated that NOAA is faced with far too much data and they don't have the technology to deal with it. However, in our case, we would be able to create a separate agency that would be able to collect this data and again, create technology that would be able to deal with this data. That was our second advantage of economic growth. We'd be able to create technology and jobs and things like that. So again, we will be able to deal with the data, and the fact that NOAA is faced with too much data once again emphasizes why they are not the ones to carry out our plan. Our harm under the first advantage does stand. It does exist. It is not being solved in the status quo. There is a need for our plan. The oceans are still on the verge of collapse, and there has been no evidence brought up that contests that. Therefore, it stands. Again, we are negatively impacting the ocean, and we need to better understand how we're interacting in good and bad ways to be better conservative for time to come. In this article from Silver et al., I'd like to explain, basically, exploration will lead to conservation and, again, protection of resources. Ocean exploration has contributed to the discovery of new ocean features, species, ecosystems, habitats, and processes. These new discoveries have led to the development of new policies and management actions. Exploration contributed to the characterization and designation of marine sanctuaries, reserves, restricted fishing areas, and monuments. So again, what this says is we will be able to better protect ocean resources once we know what's actually out in the ocean. So again, this advantage stands as comparatively advantageous to the status quo, because in the status quo, we will not be protecting the ocean, and the harm will still stand of ocean collapse and extinction. As for our second advantage, again, this one stands uncontested. We do provide economic growth through the implementation of our plan. Not only are we protecting our economy by protecting the things that our economy relies on, such as ecosystems and the ocean, we are also providing more than a double return. Every dollar we invest in science gets $2.21 back. So again, this is a comparative advantage case, and we do prove our plan to be comparatively advantageous to the status quo. So once again, going down the flow, we do retain our topicality as we are exploring the ocean through the Federal Ocean Science and Exploration Agency. Mapping does not cover what we need. And we have proven a great need for our plan in the status quo through our harms. Our adherency stands as we have clear attitudinal barrier and structural gap saying that not enough is going on in the status quo to solve for these harms, and our advantages stand as comparatively advantageous to the status quo. So thank you, and I can only ask for your strong support.
Good afternoon. So let's begin with looking at your plan as a whole. So
yes.
Under your plan, are you exploring the entirety of the ocean?
It's whatever we're going to start with $3 billion and see how much that we can explore with that.
Okay, so what is your time frame for, I guess, allocating this $3 billion?
It will be implemented immediately.
Okay. So how long is it going to take for you to eventually explore the entirety of the ocean?
The entirety of the ocean, I don't have evidence of with me. It's really big, and again, we don't know what's out there, so we don't know how much time we'd have to spend on a certain area yet.
Okay, so given like a certain area of the ocean, how long does it take current efforts to explore that?
I don't know. I don't have anything to say.
Okay. Now, under your plan, are you absorbing the NOAA and, for example, the National Science Foundation's current efforts for ocean exploration?
No.
So you're creating them alongside the existing?
Creating a brand new agency, yes.
Okay, so are the ones that are already under the NOAA and National Science Foundation going to be left where they are?
I don't believe I understand your question, but I believe so, because again, we're creating a separate agency and we're not really messing with NOAA, because their exploration is inadequate, so we don't need to go into that. And again, they're not going to be open to pure exploration, so again, we're not adjusting
NOAA.
So,
for instance, the Office of Exploration and Research is going to remain where it currently is?
Yes.
Okay. So, next let's move on to the issue of inherency. So, you cite, for example, budget cuts to the Okeanos Explorer. So what is the specific number of missions that the Okeanos Explorer cannot conduct due to this budget cut?
I don't have the numbers up with me, but what we're trying to prove by this point is that continuously, year after year, NOAA has decided to fund Okeanos and other various exploration things less and less and less, which proves a clear attitudinal barrier saying that they don't want to explore, because again, they make it less and less every year.
Okay, so how many years have they been making this loss?
I don't have the evidence of any more part of the movement.
Okay, so then you read a card talking about how OC cannot be met by private industries,
right.
And this is from Craig McLean.
I believe so, yes.
Okay, so
the Deep Sea News, the same articles that we've been reading.
Okay, so is the main issue in regards to this one of funding?
It's partly funding and it's partly that they don't have the wherewithal. The structure isn't going to work unless it's one unified agency.
What do you mean by the structure of the agency?
You can read it, but again, such a distributed structure cannot be expected to meet the challenges. If we have a bunch of private industries out there, they're all going to overlap. It may not work. What we need is a unified agency that's going to be able to work together as one.
But what's the problem with a distributed structure? Because ultimately the goal is simply exploration, right?
It's not going to work because there may be overlap, there may be times when they aren't able to collect their data, or they don't
So
don't
how is OC going to prevent the issue of overlap?
Again, it's one unified agency, so they're all under one leaderboard, which means they're all following.
Okay, and finally, could you point out where in your case it talks about how ecosystems are on the verge of collapse?
It's under our third advantage, I believe.
But could you point out where exactly in the card it states that?
Second advantage, subpoint E, we talked about
yes,
how
oceans... Could you specifically
read
the line?
I can read it, but I don't have it up with me if you'd like me to grab it. We are out of time.
Thank you.
May I take a minute from here? What we've seen is that my opponents have really failed to quantify their harms in today's debate. And with that said, my name is Jen, and I'll be your second negative constructive speaker in today's debate. I'll be going down the flow and proving to you why the affirmative team's plan should still not be implemented in the status quo. And that means I'll be first addressing the issue of topicality, a different issue of topicality, before moving on to plan workability, and finally addressing the solvency slash advantages of all my opponents' cards. Now, first, what we need to do is take a look at my opponent's definition of ocean exploration, wherein they define ocean exploration as making new discoveries, searching for new things that are unexpected and unusual on the unknown. Now, I'd like to point out that within the text of this card, they don't actually state that the creation of a new agency is exploration, nor does their definition of development state that the creation of a new agency is development. And because of this, we can see by creating a new agency, by changing the management structures and the framework of the way exploration is done, we can see that that is essentially extra topical in today's debate, because it doesn't meet it's not purely exploration and it's not purely development. And because of this, we can see that my opponents are not topical in today's debate. Now, next, in regards to plan workability, we have to touch upon the issue of why a new agency needs to be created in the first place. Now, my opponent says that private industries are insufficient because there's jurisdictional overlap. However, we have to realize that with the creation of a new agency, they don't actually take care of this harm, because all they do is they create multiple federal levels of exploration. So, for example, my partner reads that there's National Science Foundation exploration occurring, but my partner reads that there's other expeditions being conducted by the private industry. We see that as a whole, there is still going to be a jurisdictional overlap in when organizations explore the ocean. And what we have to realize is that this is okay. According to an evidence card from Damdus 2013, exploration is not necessarily something coordinated by the federal government, but rather something that's becoming increasingly involved with the private sector. Now, the evidence card explains that it's clear that exploration in the 21st century is not just for the government-supported programs anymore. We must remember that for the most of human history, exploration was driven primarily by the private industry. It wasn't until the mid-20th century that most research and development was funded by a large governmental grant programs. And there's a very real opportunity within our ocean to build these industries. So because of this, we can see that my opponent's plan of creating a new exploration agency doesn't necessarily have to occur because of the fact that by writing grants and by administrating, by having different private expeditions, what we see is that their harms are already being taken care of. Now, next, what we have to do is take a look at their cost and funding breakdown, where all of their evidence cards in regards to how they get the numbers is specifically just that NASA has a $3 billion budget. Now, nowhere in this are they able to quantify, first, how many missions are occurring, and secondly, whether the funds are sufficient, and third, how long it'll take them to actually explore the ocean. Now, they keep stating that 95% of the ocean is unexplored, but with $3 billion, they don't actually state how much of this will change, whether or not they'll be able sufficiently, whether or not they'll be decreasing this amount by 1% every year or whatnot, and how much of this can actually be applied. Now, we have to realize that ocean exploration is very expensive. According to an evidence card from Carlisle 2013, ocean exploration is very expensive because simple surveys cost $50 million. So it says that in the deep oceans, visibility is less than 100 feet, and travel speed is measured in single-digit knots. A simple seafloor survey to run a 100-mile pipeline costs a cool $50 million. The oceans are vast, boring, difficult, and expensive to explore. So essentially what this evidence card explains to us is that right now the vast majority of the seafloor and the vast majority of the deep sea is very boring. So when my opponents say that 95% of the ocean is unexplored, we have to realize that a large portion of this is going to be boring, it's going to be worthless. Now while there may be some pockets and ecosystems throughout, my opponent's plan is simply to just randomly explore the ocean and throw darts at a board and hope that they hit something. And we can see that this is not an efficient way of spending money. And furthermore, the technology used in exploring the ocean is expensive. And because my opponents are randomly throwing darts, we're seeing that the cost is going to go over a lot. And they can't actually quantify the fact that they'll be able to find anything in the first place. Now, we also have to take a look at the fact that when they talk about how there's a lack of deep sea research, we have to realize that the NOAA has been taking care of this as well as other private expeditions. According to NOAA headquarters from April 9, 2015, they state that beginning April 10th, which was, I believe, yesterday, scientists aboard NOAA's ship Okeanos Explorer will begin a series of 20 dives to investigate previously unseen depths of the Caribbean Sea and the Atlantic Ocean. During the dives are expected to go as deep as 3.7 miles. A sophisticated unmanned submarine, remote-operated vehicle card, and all ROV. And many of these expeditions and 20 ROV dives will take place in the Puerto Rico Trench, the Mariotas Trench, the Moana Channel, and the Virgin Islands Trough. And the expeditions have previously come across some unknown species, which means, and in addition to that, the next Okeanos Explorer expedition will take place from July to September in the Pacific Ocean. So what we see is that NOAA already has a targeted mission where they're specifically exploring particular areas of the water. Now, when my opponents state that NOAA is decreasing their funding, okay, but what we see is that NOAA knows where they want to go. They know where they want to find these biological hotspots. And because of this, their money and their funding is efficient. Now, when we look at when we compare that to what the affirmative team is doing, we see that their plan is significantly less efficient than what NOAA currently has. In addition to this, there are also private industries regarding the Fatal Ecosystem Studies Expedition aboard Smitched Ocean Institute research vessel. And this is going down to the Hadal Deep Sea, and it's having five deep sea vessels that are going down into targeted depths of 5,000 to 10,000 meters. And it will help answer important questions about Earth's unexplored habitats, including what organisms live there, how life adapts, and how much carbon in the atmosphere reaches the deep sea and it affects the food chains there. So we see that essentially my opponent's plan, which is collecting data on how marine life is impacted, is already being implemented in the status quo by various private sector community organizations as well as the federal government. So again, we see that their harms and their impetus for action is really lacking. Now, in regards to whether or not they can accrue their advantages, we have to look at specifically what their evidence cards talk about. Now, in regards to the first advantage, they talk about how there's a lack of information and how essentially what we're going to see is the collapse of ocean ecosystems. Now, I'd like to point out that their point D card and their point E card, their solvency and their impact, are not necessarily linked to one another. Their solvency D card talks about how deep sea exploration is valuable, whereas this potential impact of E is talking about the conservation of coastal resources. In the small text of their card, it's talking about pulling together data from a range of sources, such as fossil records, fish catches, and seabed mining. So essentially what this is talking about is the fact that coastal ecosystems are being destroyed disrupted on the surface. And even more, the evidence within their cards is they're not exactly sure whether or not these studies can be confirmed. And furthermore, when we look at this, we also have to realize that just by collecting data, it doesn't necessarily impact the change and what guaranteed policy change in regards to conservation. Now, and basically what we can see is the IPCC, the International Panel for Climate Change Control, essentially proves this. And Gunman 2007 explains that the role of IPCC is to review, assess, and publish scientific literature on climate change, its costs, and implications towards possible policy responses. It reaches a consensus view on how the scientific aspects of global climate change, as this is seen necessary for obtaining policy decisions that are based on available knowledge. And essentially what Seven's friend continues to explain is that the IPCC understands that climate change is caused by carbon emissions, and yet we haven't seen that greater knowledge in regards to this has created substantial policy action. And because policy action is the critical link in order to obtain conservation of coastal communities, we see that my opponent's plan doesn't actually include this advantage. Now furthermore, we have to add another evidence card that I won't have time to read from 2009 that basically explains how NOAA's research, how the NOAA is specifically designed for adaptation and climate mitigation and conservation strategies because it integrates ocean atmosphere and weather research that all in one, which makes it specifically designed to handle conservation strategies. So finally, what we have to see is that as a whole, opponent's plan is not significantly advantageous, and that there is, and that it would be disadvantageous to do so because of a large spending problem and as well as a misallocation of funds. With that, I can only ask for your strongest negation in today's debate.
Good afternoon. Okay, in reverse inherency attack, you're talking about overlap and expeditions. So are you saying that overlap is okay?
Well, as our evidence card explains, right now it's not the ocean exploration and exploration in general doesn't have to be conducted by the federal government.
Okay,
in fact, a number of private agencies can handle it.
Right, but you're saying that overlap between the agencies is alright.
Well, your plan doesn't actually eliminate overlap. That's what I was trying to say, because you still have the National Science Foundation, you still have NOAA, and you still have all of these numerous private activities, and creating one independent agency doesn't get rid of all of these.
Okay, so you're saying that overlap will still exist and that's okay?
It will continue to exist.
Are you saying that that's okay, or is it something that should remain in the status quo?
Well, we see that the private sector has been relatively successful at preventing overlap. For example, the NOAA has been exploring the trenches around the Caribbean Sea, whereas the private industry has been going through the Marine Trench in Japan.
In regards to the Hidalgo Schmidt Exploration Agency, how much money was allotted to that?
Well, first of all, you haven't actually quantified how much, many expeditions. You can't just do everything in terms of money. You have to do it in terms of what they're finding.
Thank you. Do you have the amount of money that was allotted to the Hidalgo Exploration?
No, but we do know that there's 5 deep sea vessels.
You stated that ocean exploration is expensive and it costs about $50 million to do one mission, is that correct?
For a simple survey, that's not necessarily the same thing as sending something down to observe marine life for an extended period of time, though.
Okay.
So the cost is expected to actually increase.
So if $50 million is the amount that it takes to explore just one area for a short amount of time, how is the current means of $19 million sufficient?
Well, we have to realize, again, that we're pointing out that there are other means. It's NOAA that's working together in collaboration with the private industry.
Right.
Evidence card specifically pointed the fact that NOAA has been focused on working with the private industry in obtaining these advantages.
So do you have, besides the $19 million that NOAA spends on ocean exploration, do you have any other numbers of money that's spent on ocean exploration?
Again, you can't just do everything in terms of money. We have to look at the
Do
fact
you have
that
any
they have
numbers of money.
For example, the Hado Ecosystem One is an extended plan to research and explore the ocean. Your plan simply increases funds.
But you don't have the amount of money.
No, I'm not
exactly
sure how much money has been allocated.
Okay, has Okinos in its, I think you said 20 dives, has it found creatures and ecosystems and things like that?
I believe it said it found some of them, but how your plan is different is that you're exploring the whole ocean. Now, Okinos explores specifically focused on a specific trench, and we have to realize that a large portion of the ocean is just water, and while there are some biological hotspots, there aren't in every single crevice of the ocean.
Can I have a copy of your Okinos evidence, as well as your Hidalgo? No further questions.
I'd like to take 30 seconds of prep time. Judges, looking at the affirmative team's case as a whole, we can see that they are both redundant and ultimately unnecessary, and for those reasons, their plan should not be passed. With that said, my name is Dante, and I'll be your first negative rebuttalist speaker in today's debate, and I'll be addressing specifically the issues brought up by the second affirmative constructive speaker, while still maintaining the arguments that were brought up by my partner. So with that said, once again, let's return to the issue of topicality. Now, my opponents counter the definition that we read also from the NOAA, which essentially states that when they talk about discovery, it's specifically excluding certain things such as surveys and research of various climatic and biological issues in the ocean. And they state namely that they're finding new things. But I'd like to point out that in the course of both of their advantages, in which they talk about specifically looking at issues in regards to conservation, we see that they specifically are looking for things in regards to conservation. Although they don't provide us with evidence talking about specific areas of the ocean and really don't talk to us about how much they're actually increasing exploration in general, we can see that what they're doing is still research, because specifically they're looking for things that help us with various issues with conservation. In this sense, we can clearly see that they are research. Also, in their cards that they read from McLean, who actually writes about the OSEA in Deep Sea News, he actually talks about how in addition to funding yearly exploration, they're also funding research, and this comes up several times in the course of their cards. Next, let's look at the issue of the inherency attacks that I made. So first, they state that when it comes to the issue of mapping that I talk about, it's different from exploration because once again, they state that there's a necessary difference between the two. I'd like to point out that once again, they don't necessarily specify how mapping the ocean to a 5 kilometer resolution has necessary gaps in it that need to be filled by exploration. Once again, they don't provide us this difference, and therefore we cannot gauge what the effect of the 95% of the ocean supposedly being unexplored is. In addition to this, when it comes to the issue of the funding cut, they misunderstood my argument by stating that we stated that a funding cut does not constitute an attitudinal inherency. That's not what we stated. We stated that their funding cut is talking about the NOAA's Office of Ocean Exploration and Research budget being cut to $19.2 million. I read a card from the NOAA in 2010 which talked about what the specific purpose of this office actually is. It's not conducting exploration and research in and of itself. It's coordinating this and attempting to facilitate this in regards to various budgetary in addition to planning issues. This means that this $19.2 billion and about $8 million cut that they're talking about is not affecting exploration and research. Once again, they're quantifying everything in terms of money, but they're not even quantifying the issue of exploration and research in and of itself with money. They don't provide us the numbers at all talking about what the current levels of funding from both the federal government and private industry specifically going to the issue of exploration is, and thus they fail to meet the burden showing that there is not enough money actually going. Next, when it comes to the issue of advantages, first they talk about how the harms in regards to data gaps still exist. But this means that they fail to respond to my argument in regards to the fact that data is booming, it's exploding in regards to various climatic and other sorts of data in regards to the ocean. They completely ignore this. Next, they talk about the issue of private businesses being unable to meet the mission of the OSEA. And specifically, they talk about this in regards to two things. First, they mention the issue of funding. But we've seen that because the private industry is already funding ocean exploration, this is already being met. Next, they talk about the issue of structure and talk about the issue of overlap. Overall, I'd like to point out that they didn't talk about how overlap is necessarily a bad thing. And if you think about what overlap would actually mean in the sense of ocean exploration, it would essentially mean that vessels would go to explore the same portion of the ocean at the same time, or rather, the same portion of the ocean. They didn't really talk about how this is necessarily a problem in and of itself, because we can look at the fact that things change over time, and consequently this could potentially actually be necessary. Overall, that we can see that with the issue of private industries, they've already been solving issues in the status quo. And the fact is, policymakers, as I talked about in the card I read, have already been using data gathered from both the NOAA in coordination with various other private industries to respond to the issues that they talk about in their advantage. The fact is, it's already being solved in the status quo. Finally, when it comes to the card that my partner was going to read in her last speech, we need to look at the fact that it's important not to separate ocean exploration and such from the NOAA, but make sure that we have an integrated system in which the ocean is monitored and explored along with various other aspects that the NOAA currently is involved with. Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution 2009. The NOAA is critical to our nation's research effort to understand our planet as an integrated system in which the oceanographic, atmospheric, and terrestrial environments interact in a highly complex fashion. Their modeling capability is considered one of the best in the world. So essentially what we can see from this is that we don't need to create a new agency. Funding and exploration is happening in the status quo, and essentially their plan does not change anything significantly. Thus, I ask you to vote nay.
I'll take 2.5 minutes of prep time, please.
Okay.
Congress approved $2 billion for NASA to explore the oceans on Europa, the moon of Jupiter, and yet we still have $19.2 million of exploration on our own Earth's oceans. Again, my name is Joshua, and as your first affirmative rebuttal to this debate, I'd like to cover the issues of topicality, inherency, and advantages, stressing to you why the judges, the negative team has not really shown you why our plan is not comparatively advantageous to the status quo. So first off, let's start off with topicality. Now, they claim that we are increasing exploration instead of research, as we are but we are exploring the places of the ocean that have not been gone to before. We have not explored them before, and as our plan mandates, it is devoted to pure exploration of our Earth's oceans. Our advantage one, subpoint B evidence indicates how we need exploration, not just research, and that is the mission of our agency. Next, they also claim that because we are creating an agency, we're not exploring the oceans. But if you look at our plan, increasing $3 billion of ocean exploration, and you look at the resolution, we see that we clearly meet the resolution and are increasing U.S. ocean exploration. Thus, we retain topicality. Next, let's move on to inherency. Now, I'd like to read a card of evidence from Benjamin Bates, a doctoral candidate in speech communication, stressing to you what inherency is. It says, type of inherency, structural inherency. Also under structural inherency are structural gaps. Although no current laws block the plan in the current system, the current actions of the present system do not go far enough in what they do. And this is what we as the affirmative team are stressing. What the current efforts, the current amount of data in the status quo are not sufficient in order to solve the harms. Our McLean 2012 evidence indicates that NOAA has crunched the exploration budget substantially each year since 2009. This displays attitudes against increasing ocean exploration. Now they claim that the ocean exploration and research sector of NOAA is not devoted solely to ocean exploration, and that's why we need a new agency that will focus on ocean exploration. Additionally, my second response to this is that programs like the Okinos Explorer and the Ivinatus programs, two exploration programs, have also been suffering from decreased days and decreased missions. This is from our evidence that we read in the 1AC. So again, the current system is not enough to solve the problems. Our Zimmer 2015 evidence and our first advantage indicates that the oceans are headed toward collapse and extinction in the status quo, even with the small sum of ocean exploration. Thus, even though the status quo exploration links to some of our advantages, it is not to a full enough extent to actually prevent the harm. Thus, there is a significant need to increase it to further protect our oceans. We still retain inherency because there is a significant need to enact our plan. Now, they also claim that NOAA is efficient. However, I'd like to read another piece of evidence that states that structural problems within NOAA actually prevent effective exploration. This is from the Committee on the Exploration of the Seas. There has been continued support for and success from oceanographic research in the U.S. The current ocean resource funding framework does not favor such exploratory proposals. Additional funding for exploration without a new framework for management and investment is unlikely to result in establishment of a successful exploration program. Structural problems limiting the effectiveness of NOAA's exploration program are insurmountable. So what we see here in this piece of evidence is that we need to increase our exploration through a new agency to guide ocean exploration efforts instead of having NOAA exploration be affected by NOAA's more applied mission. And we see that, as they stated, that NOAA's missions are going to the most interesting places, whereas exploration is not necessarily going to the places with most benefit, but learning about them in general and gaining a better understanding of the oceans in general. They also claim that private organizations solve, but the evidence that my partner read states that during recessions, funding for private exploration will go down. So this is why we need a federal agency that won't really be affected by this. In addition, it will be able to unify and efforts just as NASA has unified space efforts. Next, I'd like to move on to Advantage 1. Now, they claim that NOAA has too much data already, and that's why we need a new separate agency that focuses not on depth of data, which is research, but a general scope of data, which is exploration. We need a new agency that won't be affected by NOAA and this. They also claim that data doesn't lead to policy change, but our Silver et al. Evidence that we read in the that my partner read states that ocean exploration has led to the designation of new conservatory measures such as fishing sanctuaries, reserves, etc. This is more specific and actually deals with ocean exploration and shows how gaining exploration and understanding our resources actually increases the amount of conservation that happens in the status quo. They also state that NOAA is designed for mitigation, and again, this is applied research, not necessarily exploration. It's trying to solve a problem, not necessarily gain more knowledge so that we can make more informed policy decisions. So again, we still retain this advantage because through a greater understanding of the ocean, we will be able to protect it and we'll have a better understanding of it. Now, they state that exploration is very expensive, but our Advantage 2 turns this. It states that for every dollar we invest into ocean exploration, $2.21 will return back. So this attack does not stand, and this will win us this debate on its own. It will produce more technology jobs. It will increase the amount of research that is potentially able, and by protecting the oceans, we can protect our economy. For all these reasons, because our plan is comparatively advantageous to the status quo, and will help both guide conservatory measures as well as the boosting the economy and technology development that I ask for your strongest affirmative vote in this debate. Thank you.
1 minute 30 remaining.
Throughout today's debate, what we've seen is that the affirmative team has really failed to quantify what enough research is. With that said, my name is still Jenna, and I'll be your final negative speaker in today's debate. And in my speech, I'll go down the flow and first prove to you why the plan isn't topical, before moving on to see how their inherency doesn't stand, and finally addressing the advantages and their links. So first, what we need to do is take a look at topicality, where my opponents haven't actually addressed the fact that the creation of a new agency in and of itself is not exploration. Now, nowhere in their definition of exploration does it state that creating a new agency constitutes exploration. In fact, they define it as only looking for things that are unknown, things that are undiscovered. And because of this, we see that, in essence, the creation of OC itself is not topical in today's debate. And because of that, that should flow to the negative team. Now, however, we also have to realize that my opponents have stated that ocean exploration helps to lay the foundation for more detailed hypothesis-based investigations. However, what we have to realize is that more detailed hypothesis-based scientific investigations is exactly what's going to get us climate change adaptation. And we see that because my opponents have the advantage of climate change adaptation and climate change mitigation and climate and ecosystem resilience, we have to realize that when it comes to coming up with management strategies and looking at how this information can be applied for change, as my opponents contend they have a link, we have to realize that that's not topical in today's debate either. And because of that, my opponents go beyond the bounds of the resolution, first in creating the institution called OC, and secondly in creating management strategies for the ocean itself. And thus we see topicality goes to the negative team. Now next, in regards to inherency, my opponents have consistently stated that we do not go far enough, specifically because of the fact that we haven't been able to prove that there's been $3 billion invested. However, nowhere in their cards do they state that $3 billion have to be invested in the ocean annually. They provide no basis for what is necessary for ocean exploration. They just state that the ocean is unexplored, and that's the only harm that they present. However, the negative team has brought up several evidence cards that show that the ocean is continuously being explored by both the private industry and NOAA. And we have to realize that because my opponents say we don't go far enough or we don't address $3 billion, that doesn't mean the harms are not addressed. The private companies and NOAA are continuously investigating the ocean, and there's nothing that prevents them from doing so, and they will continue to do so as time passes. My opponents also haven't addressed the fact that when we have to look at inherency, we also have to look at the fact that when we look at this, we also have to realize that these piecemeal methods are being effective because of the fact that it's not necessarily a government institution that coordinates these effects. Now, they've talked about the fact that how overlap is bad. However, we have to realize that, again, their plan doesn't solve for overlap. All it does is it creates more overlap because they're adding a whole other layer of bureaucracy on top of all of the pre-existing ocean exploration projects in the status quo. And we have to realize that just because there's going to be overlap and that their plan doesn't exactly change this. And thus, this argument that they make is completely null. Now, because of this, we see that, first off, the affirmative team does nothing to do to justify the fact that when they say that we do not go far enough, because they don't have a basis of comparison. They don't show how far is enough. Now, next when we look at plan workability, my opponents haven't addressed the issue that their funding and their cost and funding methods don't actually quantify anything and they don't guarantee anything. Now, when we look at what they stated in the first cross-examination, they essentially stated that what they're doing is they're creating a new agency that would explore the entire ocean. However, what we have to realize is that as a whole, this is unfeasible for the United States. Because when we look at other evidence, we see that oceanography is really expensive, and that the reason that data has been on a larger scale is because it's financially and logistically impractical to sample everywhere. Scientists typically sample over time, floating with the currents and observing temporal evolution. Even an aggressive expansion of oceanographic research budgets would not do much to improve the precision of probabilistic models, let alone quickly and more accurately locate missing objects in a huge, moving, three-dimensional seascape. So essentially what this shows is that even if we increase funding substantially, we're never going to be able to obtain samples of everything in the ocean, nor would it be beneficial for the United States to do so, because not everything in the ocean is necessarily valuable and necessary to explore. And what we have to realize is that the important parts of the ocean, the parts that have biological hotspots, those are already being explored by the private industry and by NOAA. And all their plan does is create overlap. All it does is it investigates areas that are essentially meaningless for the status quo for future conservation purposes. Now, next when we look at their advantages, we have to realize that nothing in the plan necessarily guarantees what they're talking about. Because of the fact that they talk about the fact that there's data gaps, we have to realize that there will continuously be data gaps. And they haven't addressed the fact that they haven't told us how long it will take for these data gaps to completely disappear, even with the implementation of $3 billion. And the negative team has continuously asked for this statistic, and the affirmative team has been unable to quantify even how many expeditions they're doing a year with $3 billion. And because of this, we can see that not only do they not necessarily improve the data gap situation, but also that information that they collect might not necessarily be solvable. Now finally, we have to address the fact that their impact is that conservation is necessary now, and the oceans are on the verge of extinction. However, what we have to realize is that the affirmative team's plan doesn't actually change this. Nowhere do they implement conservation. Nowhere in their plan do they implement conservation policies. Nor do they address the fact that if conservation is necessary now, how long it will take for them to gain the knowledge necessary to change this fact. And because of this, we see that there is no advantage to be accrued, and their plan is redundant. And for that, I can only ask for your strongest negation in today's debate.
I believe we have 30 seconds to read a question.
I have a minute.
No. Okay, then just read.
Oh, shit.
Last affirmative speaker in today's debate. I'm going to go down the flow and again address topicality, inherency, workability, and once again go over the flow and basically state to you, the judges, why we still remain comparatively advantageous to the status quo, and that alone should win the debate. Because if our plan does have advantages over what's happening in the status quo, it should be implemented and therefore the affirmative team does win the round. So starting with topicality, the first attack was in regards to research versus exploration, and we've gone back and forth on that, but again, we do fit our definition of exploration, and there has been no reason to take their definition as preferable. We do fit our own definition of ocean exploration. We're going in, we're analyzing the biological, chemical, different parts of the ocean, and better understanding them through this agency, which is, again, to explore the ocean. Therefore, that point falls, as our agency does explore, as specifically said in our mandates. The second attack was in regards to a new agency. They say that you can't create a new agency because that's not in our definition. But again, as the resolution states, it must be the United States federal government increasing exploration. Now, they have to have some sort of means to increase exploration. And in this case, their means is an agency. And again, it's a federal agency. Therefore, it is the federal government increasing exploration of the oceans by $3 billion, which again, therefore, backs up our topicality once again and our topicality stands. Moving on to our inherency, again, we have a clear attitudinal barrier. The money going towards exploration in NOAA and other companies is regularly getting smaller and smaller. We did prove that NOAA can't cover what we want. Again, NOAA cuts all agencies dedicated purely to exploration, which again is exactly what our case wants. So NOAA clearly has an attitudinal barrier against our case specifically. Again, we did read cards that NOAA can't provide for this and won't provide for this. Therefore, our attitudinal barrier does stand. As for their third inherency attack, they stated that private industries are doing this, but again, we don't have any amount of money that they're actually putting into this or any amount of land that they've actually covered. There's been a couple dives, but again, private industries can't do what we want because again, as we stated, there's money issues. They're not able to have a reliable source of income and therefore will not be able to explore the ocean in the way that we need in the status quo. Basically, what we're saying about exploration and inherency and what inherency means in today's debate, basically what we're saying is that the status quo amount of exploration isn't doing enough and it's actually going down. So the problems in the status quo have existed since Okinos and other things have been in existence, and Okinos and other ocean exploration agencies aren't helping our harms. They aren't solving for the harms. The harms have been around for a long time, as well as these exploration agencies, and they're not solving for the harms. We need an agency dedicated to pure exploration in order to solve for these harms, as is being shown in the status quo. Moving on to the workability, my opponents were talking about private businesses and they stated that overlap is okay, and we've gone back and forth on this, but again, they refused to counter my initial argument was that private companies have an unreliable source of income and therefore will not be able to increase ocean exploration for sure, and therefore their private industries can't do what we want them to do. Our second workability attack was in regards to NOAA getting bogged down with data and that they didn't have enough technology to analyze the data. But again, this is what OC is for, is to create technology and jobs so that we can deal with the data and better understand the oceans. Moving on to our first advantage, again, we do remain comparatively advantageous to what's happening in the status quo. There are reasons to implement our case. Our first advantage of protection of resources, again, we will better be able to protect them than the status quo is doing. Our harms stand uncontested. In this article from Marine Conservation 2015, unwise practices we adopt have created problems such as the overharvest of resources, reduction in biodiversity, degradation of marine habitats and species, among others. We risk the very ecosystems upon which our survival depends. So again, our harm stands as significantly harmful, and the status quo is not solving for this. We have recent evidence saying that ecosystems are going downhill and we're causing, again, a loss in biodiversity more and more as time goes on. Therefore, that harm stands and we will be able to explore it. We will be able to solve for this as we render silver at all evidence. The first step to protect and conserve is to gather data and understand what we're dealing with. Therefore, we do remain comparatively advantageous to what's happening in the status quo. Our second advantage alone can win this debate because it is comparatively advantageous to the status quo and has remained uncontested by the negative team. Again, we will be able to protect our own economy because it is so closely tied with ocean environments, and we will be able to provide, for every dollar we invest, more than double $2.21 back in goods and services, as well as thousands of jobs and new technology, which is comparatively advantageous to what's happening in the status quo. So once again, going down the flow, our topicality stands as the federal government is increasing their exploration of the Earth's oceans through a federal ocean science exploration agency. Our inherency stands as we have a clear attitude structural gap because our harms still exist and the status quo is not solving for it. We do have a clear attitudinal barrier and our harms stand unattacked, as well as our competitive advantages being better than the status quo. Thank you, and I can only ask for your strongest affirmative.
Thank you,
guys.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Thank you.